So, good afternoon, all of you. Am I audible and visible? Please give me a quick thumbs up if my audio video is fine. Very nice. Now, just give me a second. I'll upload the file, all of you. Just give me a second, everyone. Yes. Amazing, amazing, amazing. All my dear students. So today in the must know questions in dermatology, we'll be doing a lot of case scenario based question. And till the others join, let me introduce some of the batches which we have started recently on an academy. So good morning, good afternoon, all of you. Chef, Roshita, Naveen, Javed, everybody is welcome in this session. I'm Dr. Cheshta Agarwal, your NEET-PG educator on an academy. Now, an academy is the best online platform for the preparation of NEET-PG. We give two type of paid classes. One is Plus, which give you an access to an academy like classes, and Iconic, which give you an access to both an academy and Prep Ladder. We have highly updated question bank of 25,000 plus with explanations included. We have a lot of toppers this year in NEET-PG. They have trusted an academy, and I request all of you to trust an academy as well. We have a feature where you can ask your doubt directly to the educator by raising your hand. The new batches are the clinical case batch, where the clinical case and the instruments will be discussed. The next batch for 2023 exam starting on 13th, and the target next batch for NEET-PG again starting today, that is 13th of October. I request all of you to please subscribe to an academy using the referral code CHESHTA10 and get yourself updated or get yourself enrolled. Is there any lag in audio video? Is there any lag in audio video? No. Okay, fine. Chalo, we have two exam that is the free grand test scheduled for this month for FMG on 17th 10 a.m. and INSCT 17th 2 p.m. I request all my students to get yourself enrolled into this. This is the prize list. If you want to get an Academy Plus, you can go for 6 month or 3 month. An Iconic 1 year would be sufficient. You have to use my code CHESHTA10 to get yourself enrolled. Please remember, there are many, many fake IDs which tells you that we are giving you more than 10%. Please remember, all those IDs are fake. Nobody can give you more than 10% until unless you have some scholarship or offers going on an academy itself. Otherwise, only 10% discount can be given to you. So please do not come into the trap of these people, students, whatever it is. Starting with the first question, all of you. Very nice, very nice. Vedashree, Aruna, GK, Yogesh, Saif, Rajdeep, Aditya, Saloni, Sam. Very well done. Okay. Now, if you look at this image, you can see that there is greasy lesions or dirty lesions, dirty neck appearance, along with the V-shaped nicking. Can you see the V-shaped nick here? And I think here also you have V-shaped nick. Now, all these three features are very, very classical of Darius disease. And can you tell me what is the gene defect in Darius disease? Anyone? What is the gene defect in Darius disease? Saloni, Mani, Raj, yes. Darius disease belongs to congenital acantholytic disorders. Congenital acantholytic disorder. And in this congenital acantholytic disorder, you have three very, very important things. What are those three things? First, you have deficiency of a calcium channel, which is ATP2A2. It causes abnormal function of desmoglein 3 and causes suprabasal cleft. Second is, in all these three of them, or all the congenital disorder, it is since birth. Presentations can be mainly since birth. In Darius disease, you will mainly see follicular keratosis. And in Hailey-Hailey disease, you will mainly see erosions in the flexure. Erosions in the flexures. Clear all of you? So please remember, when you see acantholytic cells with dyskeratotic cells, it becomes a case of Darius disease. While in pemphigus and all other disease, you will never see these type of suprabasal acantholysis along with dyskeratosis. I hope it is clear. Anyone? Very nice, all of you. Amazing, amazing, all of you. So here comes a lot of confusion. Now, majority of you have written the answer option number 4. But that is not the case. Now, please remember, the vesiculobullous disorders, they are broadly classified into two groups. One is immunobullous, where you have autoantibody, and another is mechanobullous, which is a genetic condition where you have congenital deficiency of one of the component. Immunobullous can occur anywhere in the body. But mechanobullous, as the name suggests, it occurs only on the trauma-prone sites. Trauma-prone sites or frictional sites. Now, if you read the question, where do you see the lesions? They are in elbow, knee, sacral. All these areas are very, very commonly trauma-prone areas. Second is the healing if it's scarring. Can you tell me what should be the level of split for healing to be scarring? Anyone? What should be the level of split for development of a scar? Priya, Happy, Sandra. Please remember, for development of scar, the damage should be at the level of dermis. So in all the options provided, only in EB dystrophica and in EB acquisita, the level is at the dermis. So you can easily rule out option number 3 and option number 4. Is this clear or not? Please give me a thumbs up. Another point is why you are ruling porphyria, because there is no photosensitivity. And why we are ruling bullous pemphigoid, because again, there is no scarring in bullous pemphigoid. Now the confusion comes EB acquisita and EB dystrophica. Please remember, EB acquisita is an immunobullous disorder, while EB dystrophica is mechanobullous disorder. And as acquisita is immunobullous, you have autoantibodies. And whenever you have autoantibodies, DIF becomes positive. Immunofluorescence becomes positive. But when there is no autoantibody, the DIF becomes negative. Clear or not? Please give me a quick thumbs up, all my dear students. If you have understood till here or not. Okay, so Priya, Happy, Sandra, Jayur, Faith, very well done, all my dear students. I hope everybody have understood till here. Now coming to another very, very important problem. Now in this question, as the DIF is positive, it cannot be dystrophic, because DIF is negative, it should be EB acquisita only. Coming to the next very interesting question. Sarita, Vedashri, Balantidium, Rajdeep, MM, Aruna, Parul, Ravi, Sam, Vedashri, Mani, Mithila, Gauda, Sandra, very well done. Please remember, this is a very interesting question for all of you. Now here, first of all, there's a farmer who has history of trauma when he was walking barefoot. So whenever you walk barefoot, and if you have trauma, you have to think about two conditions. Can you tell me what are the two DDs? Or which are the two infections which occurs on walking barefoot? Anyone? Either you develop cutaneous TB or you develop subcutaneous fungus. Subcutaneous fungus can be sporotrichosis, can be chromoblastomycosis, can be mycetoma. Anything can be there, okay? Yes, even there are other conditions parasitic, but that we are not discussing. The two main which presents with dermatological feature is cutaneous TB and subcutaneous fungus. Now let's move to the next part. He presented with a warty growth. Can you tell me which infection presents with a warty growth? In cutaneous tuberculosis, it is TBVC. And in subcutaneous fungus, it is chromoblastomycosis, which presents with verrucous growth. Balanitidium, you are right, it could be HPV, but here we are only talking about the DDs for this particular history. Okay, so farmer, barefoot walking, obviously think about TB and chromoblastomycosis. Now, how to differentiate between both? We will do histopathological examination. And when you do histopathological examination, you could see these brown color bodies, which are looking like copper pennies. I hope everybody knows that like long back, there were no coins. Like nowadays, we have metal coins, right? Aluminium or metal coins. Previously, we used to have gold coins. After that, we had copper coins. So copper coins were brown coins like this. So whenever you see copper penny-like appearance with verrucous growth, always think about chromoblastomycosis, because in tuberculosis verrucocutis, you will not see any copper penny bodies. I hope this question is clear to all of you. Please give me a quick thumbs up if this is easy and clear. The next question. Frequent repeat. Very nice, all of you. Amazing. Twenty-four-year-old male with multiple small hyperpigmented macules on the upper chest, back for last 3 months. The macules were circular, arranged around the follicle and may coalesce to form large sheath. Surface of the macule shows fine scaling, and he had a similar lesion 1 year ago, which subsides with treatment. What is the diagnosis? What is the diagnosis? Very nice, Balanitidium. Please remember, it's a case of pityriasis versicolor. Pityriasis versicolor is what? It is a yeast infection which occurs because of Melassezia furfur or Melassezia globosa. Melassezia furfur or Melassezia globosa. Now, for a yeast to demonstrate, you need to do a QH mount. And can you tell me what is the characteristic finding? We have discussed this question recently. You will see spaghetti and meatball appearance. You will see spaghetti or meatball appearance. Yafir, this is also known as banana or grape. So both these terminologies are very, very frequently used for pityriasis versicolor. Next question is on your screen. Very well done, all of you. Very nice. Okay, amazing, amazing. Now here you can see that a patient presents with multiple hyperpigmented lesions on the trunk. Now just compare this image with this image. Are these images looking very similar to each other? Are these images looking very, very similar to each other? Yes or no? Yes. Okay. They are looking very, very similar to each other. So a very close differential diagnosis of this condition is pityriasis versicolor. Just keep pityriasis versicolor in your mind and read the question ahead. She was started with topical emollient and topical steroid by a local doctor, but there was no response. So the same will be true for pityriasis versicolor also, because pityriasis versicolor will not respond to topical emollient and will not respond to topical steroids. Okay, because pityriasis versicolor is a fungal infection, it will not respond to steroid. Can you tell me among these options, which will respond to topical steroid? Which diagnosis will respond to topical steroid? Anyone? Balanitidium? Tanis? Yes. Vitiligo will respond to topical steroid. And if the patient is not responding, you can easily rule out option number one. I hope this is clear. You can easily rule out option number one. Coming to the next part. The Wood's lamp examination is orangish red. Orangish red. Is it orangish red in pityriasis versicolor? Is it orangish rash in pityriasis versicolor? The answer is no, it is yellow. So you can rule out pityriasis versicolor also. And please remember, high post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation respond very well to topical emollient. So the answer here is progressive macular hypomelanosis, which occurs because of propionate bacteria acne. Propionate bacteria acne, it dissolves the pigment, giving a white color to the skin. Okay. Valentinium, is there any confusion? Any confusion with respect to vitiligo? Please give me a quick thumbs up if you all understood why the answer is option number 4, progressive macular hypomelanosis, which occurs because of propionate bacterium acne. And in these individuals, you see perifollicular depigmentation. Perifollicular depigmentation. Clear, I think. Chalo, badhiya, very nice. A 28-year-old male has multiple group vesicles on elbow, knee, buttock, upper back associated with severe itching. The DIF shows dermal tip deposition of antibodies. What is the most likely diagnosis? Like pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis, bullous pemphigoid, or herpes zoster. Which of the following is the correct answer for this condition? Which of the following is the correct answer? Now, first of all, can you tell me what is the name given to grouped vesicles anywhere in dermatology? Anyone? What is grouped vesicle called as? This is known as herpetiform. Grouping of vesicle is known as herpetiform. So with this word only you can tell the answer of dermatitis herpetiformis, but definitely they have given you a classical site of involvement and you have the dermal tip deposition of antibody. Can you tell me, Valentinium, what type of antibody here we see in DH? What type of antibody? Okay, so everybody is saying that it is IgA type, but can you tell me against which component? What is the target antigen? Yes, the target antigen is tissue transglutaminase. Now what happens, the tissue transglutaminase is generated in the intestinal mucosa because the DH patients have underlying celiac disease. So when they eat gluten-rich diet, they develop antibodies against tissue transglutaminase. They develop antibody against tissue transglutaminase. And please remember, these tissue transglutaminase antibodies, it enters the blood. It reaches the skin and it cross-react with another antigen which is present on the dermal tip. And what is that antigen which is present on the dermal tip? It is epidermal transglutaminase. So this anti-tissue transglutaminate will cross-react with epidermal transglutaminase, causing problem at the dermal tip. And that is why you see split only over the dermal tip. And when you look at clinically, it will appear as multiple grouped follicle or multiple grouped vesicles. Understood or not? Very, very important concept. We do not have no anti-basement membrane zone antibody. There is no antibody against the basement membrane zone. Okay? The antibody is only directed against the tissue transglutaminase. Now, can you tell me what is the drug of choice for Depson? I've told you the answer. It is Depson. And if you remember, I've told you yesterday, the treatment of choice is always avoid the gluten-containing diet. Okay? Avoid bro. That is the treatment of choice. Okay. Can you tell me what is one thing, one drug, or any drug you know of which precipitate DH lesions? Frequently asked question. Please remember, potassium iodide, which is actually used for many of the dermatological conditions, it can precipitate DH, so you have to avoid giving this. Clear? Avoid this because it can precipitate the skin lesion, and this was also very frequently asked exam question for dermatitis herpetiformis. Can you tell me what is the immunological finding called as here? What is the DIF finding called as? Any appearance? In DIF, you have dermal papillary microabscess. This is actually not a DIF finding. This is histopath. But on DIF, you will see granular IgA deposits. And this granular IgA deposits will give you an appearance which is called as picket fence appearance. Picket fence appearance. You know what is picket fence appearance, anyone? Please give me a thumbs up if you know about picket fence. I will show you an image. Let's see if we have something on the net. Yes, okay. So I will be sharing my screen for everyone. Look at my screen. I'll be sharing that for you. Yes. Okay. Can you see this image, this one? Yes or no? All of you give me a thumbs up if you can see this image. Yes. So this is the picket fence. And if you look at this image, can you see this blue dots or green dot only over the dermal papillary tip? Can you see this blue green dots? I'm not talking about the red dot. Yes or no? Please say yes or no. Yes, very nice. So these are the IgA deposits which are seen in the patient of dermatitis herpetiformis. And this is the dermal papilla. So they are at regular interval like a picket fence. And that is why it is called as picket fence appearance. Understood? So now we have seen the image and it will be remembered by all of you for lifelong. Clear or not? Picket fence appearance of dermatitis herpetiformis. Okay, gee, amazing. Let's move to the next important question. A 55-year-old male presented with discoloration, thickening, and tunneling of two fingernails and one toenail. Which of the following will clinch the diagnosis? Which of the following will clinch the diagnosis? Always remember, when you have non-uniform discoloration of nail, always think about fungal infection. Always think about fungal infection. Understood? Please give me a thumbs up if you understood or not. And if you have uniform, like for example, if a question comes and it tells that all the nails have whitish discoloration, then think about some alternate diagnosis. The only reason why I'm thinking of onychomycosis here is because you can see only two finger and one toenail. So uneven, non-uniform, asymmetrical involvement of the nail give you an idea that you are dealing with a case of fungal infection, and when it is fungal infection, it becomes KOH mount. Can you tell me what will you see when you do a KOH mount? What will you see under the microscope? You will look for presence of dermatophytic hyphae and RP. Please remember, the most common differential diagnosis is psoriasis. If you remember, I told you in psoriasis you get leukonychia or whitish discoloration, you get subungual hyperkeratosis. So a very close differential diagnosis is psoriasis. But in psoriasis, usually you see it in all the 20 nails. But in fungus, you will see only few nails, plus you will not see any associated psoriatic skin condition in fungus. So like when you get a whole question or a whole patient in your exam, you will definitely understand whether you have to mark for onychomycosis or psoriasis. Can you tell me what is the reason of using KOH for looking at the dermatophytic hyphae? Why we need KOH? Why can't we look it under the microscope in a normal saline? Very nice, because it is keratolytic. Now everybody knows that in our skin we have keratinocytes like this, and these fungus, they are present inside the keratinocyte. Now when you look it under the microscope, you're not able to see these keratinocytes, so you have to add potassium hydroxide. And when you add potassium hydroxide, what happens? It will dissolve the keratinocytes. The keratinocytes is lost, and when the keratinocytes is lost, you can easily see the fungal hyphae. Understood, all of you? Please remember the why we do or why we use a fungal infection. I've told you the answer. Again, requesting, if you want dermatology to be interesting like this, please subscribe to an academy. Use my code CHESHTA10 to get an academy subscription. Use my code CHESHTA10. We have already started the batch today, so I request all of you to please be a part of the batch for NEET PG. And even INICT students, I request you to take a shortest subscription and start preparing with us. Okay, ji. Very well done, all my dear students. I think this is a very, very easy question, but still I can see that majority of you have marked one among the first three. Now, first of all, please remember, what is the difference between a bulla of vesiculobullous disorder and a bulla of infection? What is the difference between a bulla of vesiculobullous disorder and a bulla of infection? Please remember, the bulla of vesiculobullous disorder, the fluid is clear, non-turbid, clear or non-turbid. But the bulla of infectious disorder is turbid. You have a lot of pus inside the bulla, and that is what is given here, that a patient presented with multiple vesicles which are flaccid with a purulent content in them. So whenever you have bacteria taking place or bacteria causing anything, you will have a lot of inflammatory cells against it. And that is why you will have purulent content. But in vesiculobullous disorder, you will not see any purulent content inside the bulla. So the only correct answer is Staphylococcus aureus. And please remember, when this bulla or when this bulla get ruptured, the fluid can dry up to form either varnish crust of bullous impetigo or honey colored crust of non-bullous impetigo. Clear, all of you, with this question? Please give me a quick thumbs up, everyone, if you understood till here. Very, very important for your exam. Okay. This was actually this year AIIMS question, NEET PG question. 2021 NEET PG. With a little different options. Very nice, Ravi, Sam, Shrishti, Valentinium, MM. Then we have Rajdeep, Saif, Insam, Sudipta, Aruna, Gauda, Rashmi, Sarita, Salman, Divya. Very well done, all my dear students. Very well done. Now you have a 25-year-old male who has bulla on the skin and erosion in the oral cavity. So bulla plus oral lesion, and on osteopath you have intraepidermal acantholytic blister. So intraepidermal acantholytic blister with oral cavity, only one DD, and that is pemphigus. Can you tell me what is the example of intraepidermal split? Intraepidermal split with no oral lesion. What will be the diagnosis? Pemphigus foliaceus. Okay, pemphigus foliaceus. Okay. So missing question, RP, I would request you to just what do you say, just refresh your end. Maybe your internet speed is not going fine, because if it is problem from my end, nobody could have seen the question. Okay, so I think there is some issue from your end and you have to check it yourself. Okay, ji, another question. Please answer this one. A very interesting clinical case scenario based question we have right now with us. Okay, an 18-year-old boy presented with a well-defined annular lesion, the buttock with the central scarring that is gradually progressive over the last 8 months. What is your diagnosis? So only 27%. Yeah, I'm requesting all of you. I can see that. I don't know. Maybe you are very, very sleepy right now, but only 27% is not a good sign. This is something which is very frequently asked. This is PYQ. And if you're marking PYQs wrong, it is very, very hard for you to get your exam cleared. Whatever it is, whether you're trying FMG, INICT, any sort of exam, if you're marking only, or if you're marking PYQ wrong, this is like, what is called in Hindi, apne hi paon pe kulhari marna. So it's the same thing. You're actually digging your own grave if you're not doing PYQs. Clear? So please remember, I'm requesting everyone, you can join my course or you can join an academy. All the educators try their best to help you solve at least PYQs. And PYQs covers majority. They will give you an idea what all topics are important, what all topics you have to do again and again, and from where you can get a lot of questions. Please remember, this year we had 100% strike rate for NEET PG. And that is why I want all of you to please be very, very active. Clear? Okay. Now, this is a very clear case of lupus vulgaris. I will tell you one very easy trick to solve the questions like this. Whenever they write annular lesion, you have to look for the change in the center. If the center of the lesion is clear, you have to think about pinea, fungus. If center is crusted, You have to think about cutaneous leishmaniasis. You have to look about cutaneous leishmaniasis. And if the center is atrophic, you have to think about lupus vulgaris, which is cutaneous tube. Lupus vulgaris, which is cutaneous tuberculosis, Now, they have clearly mentioned that there's a long-standing history with the annular lesion and central crusting. This becomes a classical case of lupus vulgaris. Any conclusion? Please give me a quick thumbs up if you understood this, and now you will not make this question wrong if you get an annular lesion with any of these three BDs. Now, can you tell me how to treat lupus vulgaris? Anyone? How to treat lupus vulgaris? What can be done? Okay. So Ravi is saying that, ma'am, we will give ATT. But can you tell me what all drugs do you give and for how many days you have to give anti-tubercular therapy for cutaneous tuberculosis? Is it similar for pulmonary tuberculosis or it has some difference or different category to treat cutaneous tuberculosis? Anyone? Okay. So Kaushik is saying that only HR will be given for 6 months. What about others? Ravi is saying that we'll give 4 months of HRZE and 2 months of HRE. Yes, so I think you got it corrected now. Please remember that the treatment remains same, whether it is pulmonary or cutaneous TB. You give 2 months of intensive phase, that is HRZE, and you give 4 months of continuation phase, which includes HRE. We are not giving pyrazinamide in the continuation phase of 4 months. The dosage, everything is same, and the total duration will be 6 months of ATT. Okay? So please remember this point that the treatment remains same for pulmonary and non-pulmonary tuberculosis. This was again a NEET PG 2021 question. NEET PG 2021 question. I have not started the poll. Okay, maybe I have forgot. So can you see it now? Can you see it now? Yes. Okay, amazing. Sam, Balantidium, Rabab, Ravi, Kaushik. Then we have Balantidium, Anusha, Avadesh, RP, Shrishti. Very nice, all of you. Very, very nice. Now the correct answer is given to me by almost 78% of students. Here the diagnosis is Kerion, which is an inflammatory fungus, Tinea capitis. It's a variant of Tinea capitis. And you always have to do KOH mount to look for the fungal hyphae, to look for the fungal hyphae. Next question. A 40-year-old woman with an 8-month history of erythema, swelling of periorbital region, papules and plaque on the dorsal aspect of forearm knuckles with ragged cuticle, no muscle weakness, what is the most likely diagnosis? SLE, dermatomyositis, systemic sclerosis, or mixed connective tissue disorder? Very nice, Ravi, Shrishti, Rajdeep, Kaushik, Balantidium, Yogesh, amazing all of you. So, I think everybody knows this, but can you tell me why there is no muscle weakness? Do you label this patient as dermatomyositis or something else? Will you label this patient as dermatomyositis? The answer is yes. It's a variant of dermatomyositis which is known as amyopathic dermatomyositis. Can you tell me what is these lesions called as? Heliotrope rash. What are these called as? Gautron papules and plaque, and you do have other features also like Holster sign, this is H. Holster sign or anything else? Scholl sign. Now both these signs are nothing but confluent reticular erythema. Confluent reticular erythema. And if it is present on the thigh, it is known as Holster. And if it is present on the upper back, it is known as Scholl sign. So please remember, these cutaneous features have been asked frequently, and I want all of you to remember this. Okay? Very nice. So a child develops non-blanching macules and papules on lower extremities, mild abdominal pain. Skin biopsy shows IgA deposition and a perivascular neutrophilic infiltrate. This is a classical triad of Henoch, Schönlein, purpura. Can you tell me which type of vasculitis is this? Small vessel, medium vessel, or large vessel? Large vessel vasculitis, medium vessel vasculitis, and small vessel vasculitis. Can you tell me the examples of large vessel? Giant cell arteritis and Takayasu arteritis. Giant cell arteritis and Takayasu. Medium vessel, anyone? Polyarteritis nodosa or very popularly known as TAN. And another is Kawasaki syndrome or Kawasaki's disease. Small vessel vasculitis is of two types. Posimmune and immune-mediated. Posimmune or immune-mediated. The example of posimmune is, anyone, quickly tell me the answer. Very nice, Churg-Strauss syndrome, Wegener's granulomatosis, and microscopic polyangiitis. Any confusion till here? Very important. Churg-Strauss syndrome, Wegener's granulomatosis, and microscopic polyangiitis. And immune complex is Henoch-Schönlein purpura and cryoglobulinemia. Clear? Henoch-Schönlein purpura and cryoglobulinemia. So these are the example of small vessels. How they differ clinically? In large vessel, in large vessel, you will see the nerve, or you can see the vessels enlarged. And when you press those lesions, the patient will complain pain. In medium vessel, you will see more of paniculitis, and that is why these patients will have subcutaneous nodules. Or they will develop what is known as scarring, which is known as atrophy blanche. And small vessel vasculitis that classically develops palpable purpura. Understood or not? Palpable purpura is somewhat like this. You can see the lesion here. This is known as palpable purpura. So please remember, these are very, very important. Although this is taught in your medicine classes, so I'm not going to touch it much. But for all of you, try to remember these few points, because you do get a lot of questions from vasculitis in your medicine as well. Okay, fine. So we are done with HSP question. Let's move to the another one. Very nice. Now here you can see that a patient has blisters on the sun exposed areas. Always think about a photodermatosis, and here the best possible answer is porphyria cutanea tarda. Now what is porphyria? Can anybody tell me what is porphyria? What is the main problem in porphyria? Anyone? What is the main problem in porphyria? Can you answer this? In porphyria, you have defect in heme synthesis pathway. And please remember, intermittent component for porphyria, for heme synthesis is porphyrin. We have different type of porphyrins like uroporphyrin, coproporphyrin, and protoporphyrin. Uro is water soluble, so it will excrete through urine. Copro is both water and lipid soluble, so it will extract through urine as well as stools, while proto is only excreted through lipid or stools. Understood or not? Now you have different steps of heme synthesis cycle, and depending upon the type of accumulation, you will have different presentations. please listen to me very, very carefully for next 5 minutes. Give me a thumbs up if you understood till here. Please give me a thumbs up if you understood till here. So uro will excrete through urine, copro will excrete through both urine and stool, and lipid will excrete through stool only. Now just think and tell me, in the blood, where do you have porphyrin or heme? In your blood, where you have porphyrin? In your blood, you have porphyrin inside the red blood cells. Agree with me or not? Yes. So in RBCs, you have hemoglobin. Now what happens if you have any defect in the heme synthesis pathway? These porphyrins will accumulate. Like depending upon the precursor, you can have either increase of uro or copro or proto. Now the water soluble porphyrins will easily come out of the blood vessel through the red blood cell and through the blood vessel, and it will start getting deposited into the skin at the dermoepidermal junction. But the lipid soluble or the one that is protoporphyrin, it remains inside the blood vessels only. Understood? Now just think and tell me, in which type of porphyria you will see bulla or you will see scar? Whether you will see it in those where you have deposition in the skin or in those where you have deposition inside the RBCs only. Very nice. So please remember, those porphyrins which are coming out or water soluble, or where you have uroporphyrins getting accumulated, only those porphyrias will have cutaneous features in the form of bulla or scar. And what are the examples? It is PCT, CEP. These are the two examples. What is PCT? Porphyria cutanea tarda. And CEP is congenital erythropoietic porphyria. In PCT, you have accumulation of uroporphyrin gen, and in CEP, you have accumulation of both C and U. Understood or not? I'm not telling you about all the disorders. Yes, you're right about Kunther's. Okay, clear? Now, what happens when you have accumulation inside the red blood cells? Now, you all know that blood vessels are present only in the dermis. It is not present in the epidermis. So when the light or sunlight strikes the skin, the porphyrias here will degenerate, and this will cause a sharp shooting pain. Sharp shooting pain and what? Burning sensation with redness, but there will be no bulla or scarring. So please remember, in those porphyrias where you have accumulation of protoporphyrins, you will never see bulla or scarring. And the example is, what is the example? Anyone? No, it is not acute intermittent porphyria. It is erythropoietic protoporphyria. Erythropoietic protoporphyria. Please remember, acute intermittent, AIP. What is AIP? Acute intermittent porphyria. Here you have accumulation of what? You have accumulation of ALA. And please remember, ALA is not present inside the blood. It will present very similar to that of GABA. And that is why you have no cutaneous features. You have no cutaneous features in a patient of acute intermittent porphyria. You will only have features of nerve involvement in the form of psychosis, abdominal pain, vomiting, diarrhea. All are nerve induced. Clear or not? So AIP is an example of pure neural involvement, while PCT, CEP and EPP is an example of cutaneous porphyria. If anyone has any confusion, please do ask. Sarita, where is the confusion? Very, very important. Very, very important, all my dear students. Clear? PT. Okay. So, what did I tell you, Sarita, that there are three types of porphyrins? One is uroporphyrin, another is copro, and third is proto. Uro and copro are water soluble. So water soluble porphyrins will come out of the RBC, will come out of the blood vessel, and will get deposited inside the skin. And when it get deposited inside the skin, it causes bulla or scar formation. But protoporphyrinogen, which is a lipid soluble, it will remain inside the blood, and it will cause sharp shooting pain. And that will be the only complaint of the patient. The patient will not present with any bulla or scar. Again, I'm requesting all of you, if you want to understand porphyria more in details, please subscribe to an academy using the referral code JSHTA10. I will make all these topics, difficult topics, very, very interesting on the plus courses. So please do attend any of these courses. Clear? Chalo. Sarita, I hope I'm clear. Please answer this question, all of you. Very nice. Now, whenever you see a bluish discoloration on the face unilaterally, always think about nevus of ota. Can you tell me what is the condition when you see bluish discoloration on the upper back unilaterally? Can you tell me what is the name given to that condition? Anyone? It is known as nevus of ito. Very nice. And when you see similar bluish pigmentation on the lower back, what is the name given to that? Lower back, lumbar area. It is known as, yes, Mongolian spot. Mongolian spot is the name given to that condition. Mongolian spot is the name given to that condition. Very well done. Okay. Now, a 15-year-old male presented with complaints of multiple red firm papules over his face, mainly around the nose and near the mouth. Further examination reveals few lenceolate hypopigmented macules over the trunk. What is the most appropriate diagnosis? This was a question which we solved recently. I hope you all remember. I think a few days back only we have solved this question. Yes or no? This is a classical case of tuberous sclerosis or adenoma sebaceum is what is visible here. Okay, so it's a very classical question and I don't think we have to explain it again and again. The next question is on your screen. Now, very important topic I want to share that I will be discussing, I think maybe tomorrow or day after tomorrow on the YouTube channel, a very important topic, that is which branch to choose. So I have made a little short video where I have gone to different colleges and you know we have taken interviews of a lot of senior faculties and they will share their experience with respect to all the branches. Like there are many students who are confused among the branch that which branch to choose, what they can expect, you know, like what is the future in that particular branch. So I request all of you to please attend that session that is on YouTube. Let's Crack Neet PG. That is the name of my YouTube. I will share the date, Ravi, but you can just go and subscribe to the YouTube channel of an academy, that is Let's Crack Neet PG. I will be posting the video there, so you can just go and click on the notifications for my classes and you'll get all the notifications of whatever class I take. Okay, so very, very soon I will be taking that class and that will be very helpful. Like I had a good experience interviewing those senior faculties myself, so I am sure that that will help you you know, like ease your path of selecting the different branches. Okay, chalo. So for this question I want all of you to answer. Are we done with the poll for this question? Are we done with the poll? Yes. So please remember the correct answer here is fixed drug eruption. The common site for fixed drug eruption is mucosa. You see it either on lips or on the genitals and you will have a superficial erosion which is present. And that is what is visible here. So please remember a very, very classical case of fixed drug eruption. A very, very classical case of fixed drug eruption. Okay, dear. let's move to the next one. So I'm very, very tired because I had a very hectic OPD today. So I'm waiting for the class to end. Okay, Srishti, Sam, Shwetat, Valentinium, Sarita, very well done, all of you. Very nice. How many of you want to take dermatology as their branch of choice? Anyone here who is in love with dermatology and want to take derma as their branch? Anyone? Yes, so Dr. Parul. Yes, I've always seen that it is a preferred branch for girls. I think maybe because it is, comparatively light, no night duties. So, yes. Okay, very nice. Now you can see this is a classical presentation of succinate balanitis. This is what is called as keratoderma blenorrhagica. And along with that, if there is red eyes or arthritis or conjunctivitis, it becomes a classical case of because of you, ma'am. Thank you, Balanitidium. If I have contributed in your love for this branch, so I would recommend you to join in Jaipur itself so that I can directly teach Vindi classes. So that would be also very, very great for me if I will see you as a postgraduate in my medical college. That would be a very great thing for me to look for. And chalo, anyways. So you can go for it. It's a very light branch and actually a very rewarding branch. Like if you have a little bit of good setup, if you are working on the peripheries, it's a very rewarding branch. Ma'am, are you in SMS Jaipur? No, I have done my MD, MS, everything, but now I'm assistant professor in one of the private medical college in Jaipur. Not in SMS. No. It's very difficult to get in a government medical college as an AP. So many people, only one seat, and every year there are a lot of students sitting. So I'm not in SMS. I'm in a private medical college here. Okay, ji. Valentinium. Chalo. So from which place you are from, Valentinium? Are you from Rajasthan only or somewhere else? Odisha. Okay, so Raj is from Rajasthan. Okay. Which place in Rajasthan? May I know which place from Rajasthan you are in? Okay, you are from Jodhpur. Yogesh is from Udaipur. Udaipur is my city. So which medical college, Udaipur, Yogesh? Which medical college? So this is a very classical case of basal cell carcinoma. Basal cell carcinoma, which is also known as rodent ulcer. You can see that a patient with the lesion on the face, you can see that it is locally progressive with scarring in the center, everted rolled out margin, very, very classical of basal cell carcinoma. So, okay. So, okay, so this is a very classical case of basal cell carcinoma. Can you tell me any drug which can be used to treat basal cell carcinoma? This we have discussed, I think, maybe 2 to 3 days back. A drug which is used, very nice, Balanitidium. It is Vismodegib and Sonidegib. Vismodegib and Sonidegib, they are the drugs which works against sonic hedgehog pathway. Now, there are 4 types of BCC. One is nodulo ulcerative. Second is what? Pigmented BCC. Third is morphiform. And fourth is superficial BCC. Can you tell me which is the commonest one? Which is the commonest basal cell carcinoma? It is the nodulo ulcerative type, most common, which is the rodent ulcer. So initially they will form a nodule with a lot of telangiectasias, and soon this nodule will ulcerate to form white atrophic center and rolled out everted margin. Very classical of rodent ulcer. So I think with this we are done with the today's session. Please give me a quick thumbs up if all of you have enjoyed this class. Please give me a quick thumbs up. I request everyone to please use my referral code and subscribe to an academy. There are a lot many courses going on right now, so I want you to be a part of it. Please use my code CHESTA10 to subscribe an academy. You can choose shorter subscriptions as well. And anybody targeting NEET PG 2022, I request you to take a 6-month subscription so that you can be a part of this batch course. Bye bye, good day, and take care.